I am Margie Conway of Creative Heart Studios, and this is the Connecting Hearts Network program. Today is July the 4th, and for today, I cannot think of a better program to offer you than the true source of our freedom, Jesus Christ. So we are going to play part of our service from 2017 for July 4th, and I hope that it blesses you somehow.
So proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. The ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets ran where the bombs burst.
Would you give a hand to our honor guard this morning? Ask Brother Stephen Brondike to open us in a word of prayer.
Father God, thank you so much for today, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity that we have to be in your house. Lord, we are reminded by what we just saw of the incredible blessing that it is to live in a free country, Lord. But even far further than that, we are free because of what you did for us on Calvary. Lord, thank you so much for the gift of salvation, Lord. We are so unworthy, but we are so grateful that you determined us worth it. Lord, just like the men and women that have fought because we're worth it and this country is worth it to keep that freedom. Lord, may we never forget those that died for our country and ultimately you who died for us. We love you, for it's in your name we pray. Amen.
You may be seated.
Praise the Lord. It's good to be an American citizen, is it not? Praise the Lord. I tell you, that was a blessing to recognize the colors of the flag of our dear country. It's a blessing to recognize the Christian flag. And what a blessing to recognize God's holy word. Amen. Praise the Lord. Can I tell you what blessed my heart as much is that the young people that were carrying those flags and the Bible were all converts. Westside Baptist Church. Amen. Amen. Folks, that should send you home shouting this morning. I may not do a lot of shouting today, as you can tell. But it should send something, a sense of joy in our heart that God is saving souls at Westside Baptist Church. Well, gentlemen, isn't that something? Praise the Lord. Amen. Hey, folks.
This time, I'd like to take an opportunity to honor our veterans, our first responders. If you would, and you're in the house, in the choir, if you would stand at this time and let us recognize you. All of our veterans in the building, active duty, as well as our first responders that are in service with us, fire department, police, absolutely. We thank you for your service and appreciate you so much being here today. I pledge allegiance to the flag. We're going to play a little short video. We may run a little bit long this morning. I told Brother Alton there's several things that we wanted to try and get in this morning, but I want to run a quick video for you, and it's... for those of us that are old enough to remember, it goes back in time a little ways. For some of the younger people, they'll be wondering who this guy is. But it talks about the pledge. It talks about the fact that one nation under God was not always in the Pledge of Allegiance. It was not part of the Pledge of Allegiance in the beginning. But it was added. And the statement that's made at the end of that video, they've added under God, wouldn't it be a shame if the government recognizes it now as a prayer and they take it out of schools? So many things have been taken away from us. So many things can be taken away from us. But as long as we've got Jesus in our heart, they can't take that away from us. Kim, if you would.
Hey, I left home when I was 10 years old because I was hungry. And I used to, this is true. I work in the summer and I go to school in the winter. But I had this one teacher. It was the principal of the Harrison School in Vincennes, Indiana. To me, this was the greatest teacher, a real sage of my time, anyhow. He had such wisdom. And we were all reciting the Pledge of Allegiance one day. And he walked over, this little old teacher. Mr. Laswell was his name. Mr. Laswell. And he says, He says, I've been listening to you boys and girls recite the Pledge of Allegiance all semester, and it seems as though it's becoming monotonous to you. If I may I recite it and try to explain to you the meaning of each word? I, me, an individual, a committee of one, pledge, dedicate all of my worldly goods to give without self-pity. Allegiance, my love and my devotion to the flag, our standard, O glory, a symbol of freedom. Wherever she waves, there's respect, because your loyalty has given her a dignity that shouts, freedom is everybody's job. United, that means that we have all come together. States, individual communities that have united into 48 great states, 48 individual communities with pride and dignity and purpose, all divided with imaginary boundaries, yet united to a common purpose, and that's love for country. And to the Republic, a state in which sovereign power is invested in representatives chosen by the people to govern. And government is the people, and it's from the people to the leaders, not from the leaders to the people, for which it stands. One nation, meaning so blessed by God, indivisible, incapable of being divided, with liberty, which is freedom, the right of power to live one's own life, without threats, fear, or some sort of retaliation. And justice, the principle or qualities of dealing fairly with others. For all. Which means, boys and girls, it's as much your country as it is mine. And now, boys and girls, let me hear you recite the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Since I was a small boy, two states have been added to our country, and two words have been added to the Pledge of Allegiance. Under God. Wouldn't it be a pity if someone said that is a prayer and that would be eliminated from schools too?
Brother Joe.
I love America. You can tell it by my shirt, tell it by my socks. I love America. I'm glad to be a part of this. I want to announce to you, I'm glad for two little words that were mistakenly said to me. They said, we want you to say a little something about 2 Chronicles 7:14 and take about 5 minutes or so. I want to give you a thought. Every 4th of July, every Memorial Day, every Flag Day, every day American at all, we run to 2 Chronicles 7:14, we tear it out of its context, and we talk about revival in America. I want to give you the words of the verse. I want to give you a few thoughts from that. And I'd like to say to you, this verse is not written to America, and it's not written to Christians. But the application that can be made is far beyond the scope of what is just printed on these pages. Written to Israel, God said to Israel, I'll heal your land. I want to announce something to you. We don't have a land that needs healing. We're Christians. Our land is on the other side, and it needs no healing whatsoever. This isn't written to us, but there's plenty of application. I hope you'll listen very carefully. 2 Chronicles 7, verse number 14. If my people, which are called by my name, we are Christians. First part of that is Christ. We are God's people this day, and we are called by His name. Some of us are called by the name Christian, and sometimes it's made in mockery. In America today, it's not like when Red Skelton was talking about where the flag waves with liberty and justice for all and that kind of thing. We are a divided nation and divided every which way. But God says, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves. Now, I'd like to announce to you this morning that we, as God's people at Westside, even at Westside Baptist Church, we do well to humble ourselves some. But we live in a society, and we've been influenced and tainted by that society. And there's a lot of us sitting in this room here. We have a tough time with pride. We're pretty proud, and we're pretty up here, and we look down our nose every once in a while at some other folk, whether they be non-Christians or a different race, different religion, that kind of thing. We need to humble ourselves. And by the way, folks, I'm going to have the best 4th of July I've ever had before. Why? Because I'm going to take this and I'm going to run with it. There's some things that I'm going to deal with personally. And you the same. If you will take the application of this verse and apply it to your heart and your life, there can be some healing done. And on 4th of July, instead of hot dogs and hamburgers being the big important thing, you can have some healing in your personal life, in your family life. We can have some healing at Westside Baptist Church. Called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face. I heard this morning Charles Stanley talking about prayer. Boy, what a message it was. And he said that sometimes we have a God that's not the God of the Bible that we pray to. We find ourselves a God that agrees with what we want, what we think, what we like, and we pray to that God. But if we will humble ourselves and pray and seek His face, God's face, not a made-up, homemade God like we do sometimes. Oh, Lord, would you bless this? And it's so far out in left field. Listen, let's pray according to God's will. Pray in His name and pray directly to Him. The Bible says if we'll humble ourselves and pray and seek His face. And, brother, this sounds almost a little bit like preaching. I can't help it. Sometimes when we pray, it's not seeking God's face. It's seeking what we want. And I'm satisfied that if we'd apply this truth to our own lives and our own prayer life, we could make a difference. Pray and seek my face. Let me ask the question. Somebody says, I'm an American, amen. I'm a Christian, amen. How much time have you spent seeking God's face? How much time in the last week or the last month or the last year since last July 4 have you personally spent speaking to God face to face, seeking His face and His will? Seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. Oh my goodness. Our nation has got some wicked going on. And the sad thing is Noonan, Georgia has got some wicked going on. And even sadder than that, Westside Baptist Church, there's some individuals, we may have some wicked going on. I've heard the illustration. If Jesus was to come to your house this afternoon to spend the afternoon at your house, how much cleaning up would you have to do before He got there? And I'm not talking about cobwebs. How many books would you have to hide? How much work would you have to do on that remote control to say, oh, I wouldn't want him to see that station, oh my goodness. You know what I'm saying? And turn from their wicked ways. The Bible says, then I'll hear from heaven and will forgive their sin. You want to have a good 4th of July? Again, it ain't about hot dogs and hamburgers. 4th of July ought to be a celebration of the birth of our nation. But it could be a celebration of the rebirth of some hearts in this place right here. God says, I'm waiting. It's as if he's got his ear cupped like this, and he's listening. Somebody down there, somebody seek my face. Somebody pray. Somebody turn from your wicked ways. I'm waiting. And if you do your part, God says, I'll hear from heaven and forgive their sin and heal their land. Let me say something quickly.
Or so. Don't forget.
Or so. And will forgive their sin. There's a bunch of us in here this morning that if we were to have some sins forgiven in our lives, if we were to truly repent and turn from our sins and experience the forgiveness and the grace and mercy of God, 4th of July would be a revolution for you personally. The Bible says, I'll hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and I'll heal their land. Again, we don't have a land that needs healing. America, yeah, it needs some healing. But that's not the Christian's land. Our land doesn't need any healing. So I'm going to change that word land to three things, and then I'm going to be done. I'll hear from heaven, I'll forgive their sin, and I'll heal their lives. Your life, my life, personally. God can forgive and heal our inward man and our lives. Life could be different if this morning, as part of your celebration of America's birth, you were to celebrate forgiveness down here at the place. You know what I'm saying? I'll forgive their sins and heal their lives. How about this? And we'll heal their families. There's not a family in here that's not touched in some way by sin and wickedness and rebellion and dysfunction. We don't have any functional families. They're all dysfunctional to one degree or another. And God can take care of that. He can take care of it for you. He can take care of it for me. But it requires me and you turning, praying, seeking His face, humbling ourselves, and seeking His forgiveness. I'll forgive and I'll heal their lives. I'll forgive and heal their lives, their church. And by the way, did I say church? Yeah. No. Forgive their lives, their families, and their church. Westside Baptist Church needs some healing. Let me say this, there's not a better church in Coweta County. Maybe even further than that, I'm not sure. We've got the best there is right here. Not within driving distance will you find another place just like Westside Baptist Church. But you know what? Even Westside needs some healing. There's some things in this congregation, in this church body right here, that could stand some healing. And it requires one by one. I can't pray. Preacher can't pray. Brother Dave can't pray. Brother Melvin can't pray. Nobody can pray enough to heal all of us. But each one of us can pray and seek healing for individuals. Yes, sir. If enough of us get right with God, if enough of us turn, if enough of us repent, we can change Westside Baptist Church and across this nation. If folks do that in congregations, little pockets across this nation, it can make a difference in America. Amen? Happy birthday, America. God bless you.
Good job.
It is necessary for the welfare of the nation that men's lives be based on principles of the Bible. No man, educated or uneducated, can afford to be ignorant of the Bible. Theodore Roosevelt.
I have carefully examined the evidences of the Christian religion, and if I were sitting as a juror upon its authenticity, I would unhesitantly give my verdict in its favor. I can prove its truth as clearly as any proposition ever submitted to the mind of man. Alexander Hamilton.
George Washington Carver, botanist, inventor, the secret of my success, it is simple, it is found in the Bible. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy paths. George Washington Carver, 1939.
We have this day restored the sovereign to whom all men ought to be obedient. He reigns in heaven, and from the rising to the setting of the sun, let his kingdom come. Samuel Adams at the signing of the Declaration of Independence.
A thorough knowledge of the Bible is worth more than a college education. Theodore Roosevelt.
Amen.
Benjamin Franklin, founding father, American inventor. I therefore beg leave to move that henceforth prayers employing the assistance from heaven and its blessings on our deliberation be held in this assembly every morning. Benjamin Franklin.
We recognize no sovereign but God and no king but Jesus. John Adams and John Hancock, April 18, 1775.
It cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians, not on religion, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. For that reason alone, people of other faiths have been afforded freedom of worship here.
Without God, there is no virtue because there is no prompting of the conscience. Without God, there is a coarsening of the society. Without God, democracy will not and cannot long endure. If we ever forget that we are one nation under God, then we will be one nation gone under. Ronald Reagan, 40th U.S. President.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning, isn't it? Praise the Lord. Well, I do want to mention a couple of things I overlooked just a minute ago. I did want to mention how nice it is to have. Now, both of you, forgive me. I've got you as the Hallmesser family from Mississippi. And so we appreciate them coming and being with us today. They're here on vacation. And so they chose to come and to worship with us. We appreciate that so much. I also wanted to mention that Brother Stephen and Miss Amanda had their baby. I think it was Monday night. Was it Monday night? Or early 2:28 Tuesday morning. And a healthy girl. And what's her name, brother? Hannah Grace. Isn't that wonderful? So, Miss Hannah, we're looking forward to seeing her. Hopefully, you'll be up to being here next Sunday. I didn't touch anything. Okay. But I just want to tell you, choir, you did a fine job this morning. And then they did a good job. I think we've had enough technical issues today to finish us out for the whole year. But I appreciate the hard work that goes into these fine, special Sundays. And I tell you, I love America. I was listening to a talk radio show some time ago in Greenville, South Carolina. And they had a man that was hosting the show that had graduated from a liberal secular college. And he was quoting some of our forefathers, and some of the things he was saying, I believe, were inaccurate. And he made our forefathers sound like a bunch of pluralists, men that believe in God, but not necessarily in Jesus Christ as God in the flesh. Well, I've done research, and I'm glad to report that it's not true, that our forefathers, our founders, many of them, not all, many of them, I believe, were born-again Christians. John Adams was a signer of the Declaration. Y'all bear with me this morning. The signer of the Declaration of Independence. A judge, a diplomat, one of the signers of the Bill of Rights, second president of the United States, said without religion, this world would be something not fit to mention in polite company. I mean hell. He also said the Christian religion is above all religions that ever prevailed or existed in ancient or modern times, the religion of wisdom, virtue, equity, and humanity.
That goes along with Philippians chapter 2, where it says, wherefore God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. I know the reason that Christianity is superior and above any other religion is because of the name Christ. His name makes Christianity superior to all other religions. I know this burns up little Bernie Sanders' mind and heart. He hates God, he hates Christians. But it doesn't matter, because we serve a Christ whose name is above every name. That name is Jesus. Every knee should bow. Listen, at the name of Jesus, one day that man, Bernie Sanders, that hates this country, hates what we are, hates America, and hates Christians, one day he'll bow before the one whom he hates so much. Mr. Obama one day will bow before Jesus Christ and confess his name as Jesus and Lord. He won't want to do it. He'll have to do it because Christianity, Christ, is above all and every other name. Excuse me. He goes on to say, I have examined all religions, and the result of this is that the Bible is the best book in the world. And that's something our founding father. Hey, teenagers, you're in high school. Those teachers get up and tell you that we were not based on Christian principles. You just come to preach your midget, and I'll give you my notes. And you can go to school and preach it to them. Tell them the truth. I have examined all religions, and the result is that the Bible is the best book in the world. Hebrews 4:12 specifies why it's the best book. For the Word of God is quick. For the Word of God is powerful. For the Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner. What is a discerner? The Word of God is a discerner of the thoughts, a discerner of the intents of the heart. What other book, what other word knows how evil or how holy our hearts are? The Word of God. And that's why John Adams held so tightly to the belief that the Bible is the best book in the world. John Quincy Adams, the sixth president of the United States, diplomat, secretary of state, U.S. senator, and U.S. representative, said, my hopes of a future life are all founded upon the gospel of Christ, and I cannot cavil or quibble away. Philippians 1, verse 19, supports John Quincy Adams' thoughts. He says, for I know that this shall turn to my salvation through your prayer and the supply of the Spirit of Jesus Christ. Remember, John Quincy Adams says, my hope of a future life are all founded upon the gospel of Christ. Verse 20 says, according to my earnest expectation and my hope that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with all boldness as always, so now also Christ shall be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or by death. Alexander Hamilton revolutionary general, signer of the Constitution, author of the Federalist Papers, Secretary of Treasury, following his duel with Aaron Burr in those final 24 hours while life still remained in him. Hamilton called for two ministers, the Reverend J.M. Mason and the Reverend Benjamin Moore, to pray with him and administer communion to him. Each of those two ministers reported what transpired. The Reverend Mason recounted this. Here, the general, speaking with Hamilton, letting go my hand, which he had held from the moment I sat down at his bedside, clasped his own hands together, and looking up towards heaven, said with emphasis, "I have a tender reliance on the mercy of the Almighty. Through the merits of the Lord Jesus Christ." Titus 3:5 speaks of our merits, not by our merits, not by our works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us by the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Ghost, which he shed on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Alexander Hamilton had it right. And according to his testimony, I believe we'll see this man in heaven one day. I don't care what you've read about him, whether it be good or bad. Those merits did not send him to heaven, nor did they send him to hell, because he was reliant on Jesus Christ. Josiah Bartlett, military officer, signer of the Declaration of Independence. Excuse me. Signer of the Declaration of Independence. Judge. Governor of New Hampshire called for the people of New Hampshire to confess before God their aggravated transgressions and to implore his, meaning Christ's, pardon and forgiveness through the merits and meditation, listen to this, mediation rather, of Jesus Christ. He believed, this Josiah Bartlett believed in 1 Timothy 2:5, which says, "For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus." I don't know what you've read about Mr. Bartlett, whether it be good or bad, it doesn't matter to me. I believe we'll see him in heaven because he believed in the mediator, which is the Lord Jesus Christ. Then I was looking about Gunning Bedford, a military officer, member of the Continental Congress, signer of the Constitution, and federal judge. He believed, ladies and gentlemen, not in a God that hovered in the clouds looking around to see what may happen, but he believed in the Trinity. The triune God, he said. He said the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be ascribed all honor and dominion forever. Amen. 2 Corinthians 13:14 says the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the Son, and the love of God, the Father, and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen. I believe Mr. Bedford loved God and understood there was a Trinity. There was a God the Father. There was a God the Son and God the Holy Spirit. Then we found Elias, and I had a hard time with this one because I think he was French. Boudinot, President of Congress, signed the peace treaty to end the American Revolution War. First attorney admitted to the U.S. Supreme Court bar. Framer of the Bill of Rights. Director of the U.S. Mint. Wrote this letter to his daughter. This letter says, "You have been instructed from your childhood in the knowledge of your lost state by nature. The absolute necessity of a change of heart and an entire renovation of soul to the image of Jesus Christ. I'm telling you that this man, Mr. Bonnot, he understood the very same thing I believe that we all need to understand. I believe we need to understand that it's important to train up a child in the way he should go. And when he is old, he will not depart from it." Jacob Broom had come to the same conclusion where he wrote a letter to his son, said James, to his son James, attending Princeton University, I flatter myself, you will be what I wish. But I don't be so much flatterer as to relax of your application. Then he said this, "Don't forget to be a Christian. I have said much to you on this head, and I hope an indelible impression is made." Jacob Broom also believed in training up a child in the way they should go. Church, we need to deeply be moved by these two men and follow their great, great example. John Dickens, signer of the Constitution, governor of Pennsylvania, governor of Delaware, general in the American Revolution, rendering thanks to my Creator for my existence and station among his works, for my birth in a country enlightened by the gospel, and enjoying freedom for all his other kindnesses. To him I resign myself humbly, confiding in his goodness and in his mercy through Jesus Christ for the events of eternity. Governments could not give. Now, this is John Dickinson still speaking. Governments could not give the rights essential to happiness. We claim them from a higher source, from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. These are men of renown, our brethren in Christ, but forefathers and countrymen believe these things, that happiness does not come from government, but comes from the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We have today in this country, I never dreamed I'd ever see so many Americans born with their palms up, looking for somebody to give them something. Oh, the government would just give me health care, then I could be happy. And then you have the homosexuals. Oh, the government would just make perverted marriage legal, then we could all be happy. And they're still miserable in their sin. We have over 50, first time in this country's history, we have over 50% of Americans receiving some kind of government help. And they're still miserable. There's only one place where happiness can come from. One place it derives, and that is through the knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. You say, preacher, don't you know Christians that are sad? Yes. Do you know Christians that suffer from depression and oppression? Yes. But deep in the middle of the darkness of the soul, there's a glimmer of light because Jesus Christ dwells there. Happiness. I remember a song that came out in the 70s that we sang called Happiness Is. Happiness is to know the Savior, living a life within His favor, having a change in my behavior. Happiness is the Lord. Happiness is a new creation. Jesus and me in close relation, having a part in His salvation. Happiness is the Lord. Happiness is the Lord. I'm so glad that through Jesus Christ, no matter how dark our days get, we will have a form of happiness and joy. Gabriel Duval, a soldier, a judge, selected as a delegate to the Constitutional Convention, Comptroller of the U.S. Treasury, U.S. Supreme Court Justice. He said this close to his death. He said, I resign my soul into the hands of the Almighty, who gave it the humble hopes of His mercy through our Savior, Jesus Christ. And with this, I will be finished. With this, I will be through. The signer, Elbridge Gerry, the signer of the Declaration of Independence, member of the Constitutional Convention, framer of the Bill of Rights, governor of Massachusetts, and vice president of the United States. He called on the state of Massachusetts to pray with one heart and voice that we may prostrate ourselves at the throne of heavenly grace and present to our great benefactor sincere and unfeigned thanks for His infinite goodness and mercy towards us. He also said, and for our unparalleled ingratitude to that adorable being who has seated us in a land irradiated by the cheerful beams of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Let us fall prostrate before offended deity, confess sincerely and penitently our manifold sins and our unworthiness of the least of His divine favors, fervently implore His pardon through the merits of our mediator, Jesus Christ. John Hancock, and I'm almost finished, signer of the Declaration of Independence, President of Congress, Revolutionary General, and also a governor of Massachusetts. Massachusetts must have been a wicked state because he also called Massachusetts to pray. Pray that all nations may bow to the scepter of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Now that's a prayer. Amen. Then he also said they need to pray to cause the benign religion of our Lord and Savior to be known and understood and practiced among all inhabitants of the earth. He also encouraged them to pray to confess their sins before God and implore His forgiveness through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ our Lord and Savior again. He also said to pray that the kingdom of our Lord and Savior may be established in peace and righteousness. He told them to pray that with true contrition, with a heart, we may confess our sins, resolve and forsake them, and implore the divine forgiveness through the merit and meditation of Jesus Christ, our Savior. And finally, to overrule all commotions in the world to the spreading and the true religion of the Lord Jesus Christ in its purity and power among all people of the earth. Can you imagine? Can you imagine what would have happened if in the state of Georgia, if our governor, what's that guy's name? Neil? Say it again. Deal, thank you. I don't want to remember his name. Can you imagine if he would have stood, if he would have stood up and called for statewide prayer, and instead of opening up the bathrooms to the transgender perverts in the state of Georgia? Can you imagine if he would have stood up against the homosexual crowd and called this state into prayer? What could have happened in the state of Georgia? What would have taken place in the churches across this state? If he had done that, if he had stood against the homosexuals and stood with Christ, I believe Georgia could possibly be experiencing a statewide revival. I'm just talking to you about just a few of these great men that led our nation to what ultimately is greatness. If it had not been for these men standing hard and strong and long in the beginning, our nation would be worse off today than it is. It's worse off today because men have no longer stood like these men stood. Men no longer stand like these men stood. What are we going to do about it? I believe that our nation's in the mess it's in, not because of the politicians. We're in the mess we're in because we're not practicing what Brother Joe talked about a little earlier. And we are not seeking God concerning our own lives. And our own lives have become tainted. And because the Christian lives have become tainted with the world is now going to hell in a handbasket. We don't need to look at the politicians and blame them, although they've done a lot of damage. I believe Christians this morning, we need to look within ourselves, look in the mirror, and understand that we're guilty. We're the ones. We're the ones. We've dropped I got chill bumps this morning when the flag came through. But I'll be honest with you. As much as I love this flag, when that flag came through, I got chill bumps on top of chill bumps. The problem is we've let this banner fall to the ground and get the dirt of this world on it. And it's no longer respected. The world moved instead of the church holding its ground. It moved with the world. It moved a little more, and the church moved a little more. And today, you can't tell the difference between 90% of a church. Just take a picture of it. And you can't tell the difference between a church worship service and a rock and roll concert. Because we moved. We're the problem. We're not the problem if we stand. See, yeah, but preacher, we don't have 10,000 in church on Sunday morning. We can. If you want me to stand up and preach on secular issues on Sunday morning, we can. 2 weeks ago, I had a lady call me and tell me I preached too much about salvation on Sunday morning. Wanted to know why I couldn't preach on getting out of debt. Well, bless your heart, here it is. Spend less than you have coming in. There, you got it? Don't buy something if you can't afford it. Okay, let's move back to salvation. Now, Jesus is Lord. He's Lord. He's Lord of Westside Baptist Church. And whether America knows it or not, and most of it doesn't, he's Lord of America. Mr. Putin can't make a move. He can't do anything without permission from the Lord. Everything that's going on is being permitted by the Lord. Ladies and gentlemen, Jesus is Lord. Jesus Christ is God. And we can trust him to keep our country. We can trust him to keep our church. And we can trust him to keep our souls. In the name of Jesus, may we look within ourselves this morning and see if there's something that we can tweak. God, how can we be better Americans? The answer is, be a better Christian. How can we change our country? Change our hearts toward the Lord Jesus Christ. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Let's please stand. This morning, I don't apologize for going a few minutes over. We have been blessed enough to recognize what God has done for us in America. With all the flaws that we have, America is still the greatest country on earth today. And I know we pick her apart, and many times she deserves it. But I only hope that this morning, oh Christians, that maybe we'll pick ourselves apart. That maybe we'll analyze and scrutinize and say, God, help us. Help me, Lord. Help me, Lord, to wave your banner high that I not allow it to hit the ground, lest it get the dirt of this nasty world on it. Help me, Lord, as I go out. Help me, Lord, as I go out to this lost and dying world. Help me to fly this banner respectfully and effectively. In the name of Jesus, this is the invitation this morning. Would you come?